advances, looking for troubles, and you're telling me them lies. Oh, make no mistake, I'll cut you right down to size. Don't go looking through no dead man's eyes.
Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. It began as a podcast, went live on the net, and transformed into a full-blown empire across the web, on Fight Now TV, and on radio stations around the world. It's the only daily boxing talk radio show on the planet, hosted by the only guy with the balls to do it. Many have stepped into the ring. Many have tried to take the belt. And one by one, they've fallen. Another victim of the undisputed heavyweight champion of Boxing Talk Radio. Talkin' Boxing with Billy C is on now.
My style is impetuous, my defense is impregnable, and I'm just ferocious. I want your heart.
And we're coming to you live from the Billy C. Studio in Lake George, New York. I'm Bill Caligiuri. It's time for Talking Boxing with Billy C. Good morning, good day, good evening. Whenever you're listening, hope you're doing all right. We got a busy show scheduled for you today. And we got another busy one scheduled for tomorrow. Hey, programming note, we will not be doing a live show next week on Thursday or Friday. We're going to be up at the International Boxing Hall of Fame. We'll be kicking off a couple of live broadcasts on Friday. And then if you're not going to be up in Canastota, New York on Saturday to be part of our live audience from 2 in the afternoon till 2 in the morning, make sure you tune in to www.ldltv.com. Trust me when I tell you, it's going to be a great show. And speaking of show, today's show is being brought to you in part by The Gentleman Boxer. If you're looking for a great read, this is the one to get. My man Ian Grumaza does a fantastic job bringing us back in time to the roaring 1920s when boxing was extremely popular. And this book focuses on the bantamweight division and specifically a fighter named Joe Grimm, who was a pretty talented young man. And on the verge of a title shot, he decided to walk away from the sport to help with the family business. It's a great story. It's the type of book you just can't put down. Get yourself a copy of The Gentleman Boxer, where all good books are sold, including Barnes & Noble or Amazon.com, or just click on one of the Gentleman Boxer banners that's located up on BillyCBoxing.com. Today's show is also being brought to us in part by the Titty Grab Game. Hey, man, if you're looking for a type of game that, you know, could fool around a little bit with couples and maybe, you know, have some drinks while you're doing it, and then who knows, maybe get a little lucky later on. Well, this is the game for you. Check it out, www.tittygrab.com, to get all the information about the game, where you get it, how to play it, all that stuff. What comes with it? Yeah, it comes with it. You want to know? It comes with a titty. Uh-huh, it does. www.tittygrab.com. And also, today's show is being brought to us in part by the International Women's Boxing Hall of Fame and their inaugural event, which is taking place July 10th in Fort Lauderdale. I'm going to be there. I'm going to be doing the MC, and I'd love to have you there, too. It's a big, fancy old luncheon at an affordable price. Check out www.wban.com for all the information about this fantastic event. By the way, if you can't make it to Fort Lauderdale on July 10th, fear not, because if you want to watch it, you can watch it for free on www.ldltv.com. Today's show is also being brought to us in part by the Turning Stone Resort and Casino in Verona, New York, and their next boxing event, which is next Friday. It's a Mike Tyson promotion, and it's going to be another great show up at the Turning Stone. Get yourself some tickets right now by visiting www.turningstone.com. You can get tickets starting at $15 a piece. You can also get tickets by visiting our website, www.billycboxing.com, and clicking on one of the Turning Stone banners, which has a picture of Mike Tyson on it. So, and finally, today's show is being brought to us in part by LDLTV and Billy C's Hall of Fame Weekend Special. You can find out all the information about the show, or I should say shows, by visiting www.billycboxing.com and clicking on the banner that says Billy C's Hall of Fame Weekend Special. And it's all being made possible thanks to Sal's Neighborhood Pizzeria, the Courtyard in East Syracuse at the Carrier Circle, and the Wax Museum with Ronnie Dark's Rock and Roll Show, which is on Sunday nights, WVOA 87.7 on the FM dial or WVOARadio.com. I got some final press conference quotes, some quick quotes for Carl Froch and Georgie Groves. Also for the Nonito Donaire challenge to Simpawee Vatika. We got some also quotes on the upcoming event in another 2 weeks. Ruslan Pradagnikov against Chris Algieri. And obviously some other stupid comments by Freddie Roach. An evening with two former great heavyweights. I'll talk about that. A signing with Mike Tyson's group. And some other things we'll be talking about a little bit later. Speaking a little bit later, my main man, Larry Hazard, will be coming on in about 20 minutes or so. And Dax Khan will swing on by and give us his weekend boxing schedule roundup. But first, I got some emails to read like we always do. I want to give a shout out to my man, Hawk Mustang. Now, Hawk is a guy that communicates or used to communicate with us through the YouTube version of this show. And I happened to have been doing some stuff on the YouTube page, and I caught a comment from my man Hawk, and he says, I decided to not respond to comments. Hawk, man, you know, you got to listen to the show. If you want your comments discussed on the show, you got to email me. It's real easy, man. Take the minute to email me instead of typing it at YouTube, and we'll read your comments. The email address is billy@talkinboxing, TalkinBoxing, and I'll be glad to read it. However, since you've interacted with the show in the past, I will get your question out right now. He says he wants to know why HBO did cut ties with Golden Boy. You know, I think the main reason had to do with the negotiation around the Floyd Mayweather situation. And I also believe that Richard Schaefer kind of ruined the relationship between Golden Boy and HBO. And HBO wanted to make a stand on it and basically said, hey, we don't need you. You know, Richard Schaefer took this this stand like they became boxing, almost like the WBC. And the way this guy is approaching stuff, the way he still approaches stuff, is that, you know, everyone needs him. And it's a joke because, you know, boxing has a tendency to chew people up and spit them out. And sometimes it takes a little longer to spit them out, but they still chewing them. And I think Richard Schaefer is going to be no different, just like some other people that I feel that appear to be doing really well now that won't be in the future. But, you know, that's for that, and we'll see then. Hey, that prompts me to say, Oscar, now's the time to get rid of Richard Schaefer. Really, now's the time. And the timing couldn't be better for Oscar De La Hoya. I'll tell you why. Number one, he built the company with his namesake, the Golden Boy. You know, people loved Oscar De La Hoya as a fighter. They still love him today. He was a good fighter. He was a great fighter. He's a Hall of Fame fighter. You know, yeah, you can say a lot of things about Oscar, his choice of fishnet stockings or high heels or his drug abuse and alcohol abuse and womenizing and all those things. You could say all that about him. But the one thing you can't say is that he ducked anybody, because he didn't. And personally, I think in the large scope of things, you know, all-time greatness, Oscar's right there. And I believe he'll be above Floyd when it's all said and done, because boxing is a lot more than just an undefeated record and a bank account. And by the way, Oscar's bank account ain't too bad. So now I think it's time for Oscar to kick Richard Schaefer to the curb. Richard has been taking advantage of Oscar and trying to form a company. It's no secret. He and Al Haymon putting together a team, thinking that they're going to control it. But the problem is that they've been using Floyd's money, man. You know, and I think Floyd's finally got it, and he put his foot down. I think the first step on that was, you know, talking with and planning on working with Top Rank and Bob Arum. And then the second thing was just recent when I was reading some quotes of his at the press conference. Usually we used to get all the rah-rah quotes from Richard Schaefer. So now's the time for Richard Schaefer to find another job. And I think that Oscar should help him along the way as far as, you know, give him a kick in the ass right out the dough. That's what I think. Anyway, so by the way, Hawk, email me next time, will you, bro? My man Jesse, what's the show without Jesse keeping us on our toes? He says, hey, Billy C, Felix Verdejo has said that in the future he would like to face Oscar Valdez. What's your thoughts on who wins and how the styles match up? Well, you know, it's a pretty amazing situation when you look at these two young fighters, Felix Verdejo and Oscar Valdez. Extremely similar in paths to where they are today. Both are young fighters. Felix Verdejo is 12-0 with 9 knockouts. He fights in the lightweight division, and he's currently ranked at number 123rd. He's 5'9", 72-inch reach, only 34 rounds as a pro with a 75% knockout ratio. He's 21 years old. Here's the thing. He is already scheduled to fight on June 7th. Against Engelberto Venezuela, who's 8-1. He's on the undercard of the Miguel Cotto Sergio Martinez fight in New York City. You know, when I look at this guy, you know, he's fought some pretty good opposition. His combined opponents' records for his 12 wins and no losses: 65 wins, 42 losses, and 6 draws. Only 3 of his opponents have actually had losing records, which is unusual in today's sport of boxing to see a 12-0 kid. Normally, they haven't even fought a guy with a winning record. So this is kind of a breath of fresh air. Now, you know, he wants to fight Valdez. I could see where these two paths are going to cross. But I think they're going to cross down the road a little bit because it wouldn't make sense for them to fight this early on. The similar situation is when you look at Oscar Valdez, he's ranked in a weight class below in the super featherweight division or junior lightweight, however you want to look at it. He, too, is undefeated, 11-0, but all of his wins have come by knockout. He's the smaller fighter, and he's 2 years older. He's 23 years old, 5 foot five and a half, 66-inch reach, 33 rounds. If you recall, Verdejo had 34. His knockout ratio is 100%. But check this out. His combined opponent's record, and again, he's only got one less fight than Verdejo. He's got 60 wins, 41 losses, and 5 draws. Remember, Verdejo had 65, 42, and 6. And of those 11 fights, only 2 had losing records. Both very similar paths to where they currently are now. Same level of opposition, same timetables. They both started at in the late 2012. Hey, listen, I think someday if these two guys do meet in a ring, it's going to be an extremely entertaining fight. And I wouldn't be surprised if they do meet maybe 10, when they each get about 10 more fights from now, and maybe they'll be in the same weight class. For Deho, he's got the height advantage over Valdez, but Valdez looks like he's got the punching power, so it ought to be an interesting fight. I can't give a prediction now because actually they're in two weight classes and they're very similar. Right now, I call it a tie, but a very interesting matchup that my man Jesse lays out to me. He also says, what's your thoughts on Vyacheslav Envy? What is it? Vyacheslav Envy Shabransky. Always keeping me on my toes, Jesse. Well, Shabransky is an undefeated fighter. He's currently living in Los Angeles, California. He's from the Ukraine. His nickname is Lionheart. 27 years old, 25 rounds of pro with an 88% knockout ratio. Undefeated at 8-0 with 7 knockouts. This guy's been in tough, man. He's only got 8 fights. Only one of his 8 fights is what I would consider a weak opponent, and that was a 1-5 guy. His combined opponent's record is 35-19-5. What do I think of him? I think he's a really good prospect, and he's worthwhile to keep an eye on. Keep this in the back of your head. For a fighter that's only got 8 professional fights under his belt, he's already ranked at number 55 by the computer in the light heavyweight division. Hey, I'm going to take a short break. I'll be back in 2.
If you're in upstate New York and you need a trucking company, then you need Roselli Enterprises. Roselli Enterprises is trucking at its finest. They have it all. Dump trucks, dump trailers, walk-in floors, flatbeds, flow boys, tankers, loaders, and a full line of roll-off containers for any job, big or small. Roselli Enterprises is also the source for all your sand, gravel, and topsoil needs. Visit them on the web at RoselliTrucking.com or call 315-433-5115. That's 315-433-5115 and tell them Billy C sent you.
Are you ready, America? Then let's get it on with Fight Now TV. It's time, fight fans. Your channel has arrived. All the fights, all the names, all the action. From world-class boxing events to mixed martial arts showdowns and other combat sports matchups, Fight Now TV delivers the hits and more. Call your television provider and tell them you want to get it on with Fight Now TV. For more details, go to fightnow.com.
We've got a great matchup tonight. Fighting out of the left corner is the number one ranked contender.
No, he is not.
I'm sorry, but who are you?
I am the IBO computer. I am programmed to provide only fair and unbiased boxing rankings. This fighter is the number 15 ranked contender.
Fair and unbiased boxing rankings? That's a new concept.
Actually, it is not. The IBO has provided unbiased computerized rankings for many years.
Well, we've still got a great fight tonight, folks. In the left corner is the number 15 ranked contender.
The IBO, the champion of integrity. Learn more at IBOboxing.com.
As a young boy, all Billy C dreamed about was one day having his own catchphrase.
And we're back. And we're back.
One boy, one dream, one day, everyone will say.
And we're back. 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 And we're back.
Catchphrase, coming soon to a theater near you.
And we're back. You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C Show. Hey, man, don't forget, do me a favor, follow us on Twitter, will you? Will you? It's at Talking Boxing. That's TalkinBoxing. And if you have a friend or two, have them follow us, too. And by the way, here's some more homework for you. If you're a, well, it doesn't matter where you get your TV service, but specifically if you have Dish Network, now's the time to really push to ask for the Fight Now channel. I guess they're on the verge of bringing us on, and it's real important to us. So if you have Dish Network, or even if you have, you know, DirecTV or any other cable provider, call them up and tell them you want the Fight Now TV channel added to your sports channel lineup, and make sure you mention the Talking Boxing with Billy C Show, and I'd appreciate it. Well, we got some more emails before we get Larry on the phone, get his thoughts on the fights from last weekend and this weekend. I got some final quotes from the press conferences. I'm also going to give you all the fights that were included on this week's Billy C Challenge as we determine who's going to win the month of May. And it's wide open right now. So this one's from Hawaii Mike. And he says, hey, Billy C, I got to clarify a couple of things about Joe Calzaghe. I know you're not a big fan, but I thought that the guy was the goods, and I'd back him to beat Andre Ward in a mythical matchup. I think Hawaii Mike's been drinking too many of them drinks with the umbrellas in it, man, if he thinks that. But anyway, and by the way, drunken Hawaii Mike, Alex ran the title bout championship computer game, and the game agreed with you, which shocked me. But anyway, he says he had too much hand speed, too much volume, and Ward lacks the power to keep him off. You know, that's a false statement. That's an extremely false statement. All you got to do is look at Andre Ward's last fight. You know, listen, Andre Ward is a kind of fighter that does what he needs to do to win, but he's got the power. He's a complete fighter, man. He really is. Unfortunately, we don't get to see him enough. But I think he's the complete fighter. Anyway, he says, I can't think of anything Ward does better than Joe Calzaghe, and can't wait and can't see in my mind's eye how he'd beat him. I do. It's called little pitter-pat punches. It's called Joe Calzaghe never really, you know, fought the best in the division while he was active. I give him a lot of credit for maintaining world class and world championship status throughout most of his career. I give him credit for staying retired. I give him credit for retiring undefeated. But, you know, for the most part, I criticize him for never leaving the comfort of his home, except for the last two fights when he fought, assuming old, both of them are still fighting today, Roy Jones Jr. and Bernard Hopkins. And I just think he was overrated. We're always complaining about fighters being underrated. I think Joe Calzaghe was overrated, you know. And hey, he's a paisan. I still think he was overrated. But I respect your opinion, Hawaii Mike, because I'm still hoping someday you surprise me with a round-trip airline ticket to Hawaii. That's why. Anyway, he says, the point I wanted to clarify was that Joe did fight outside the super middleweight division. In his last two fights, he gained and then retained the linear, a.k.a. ring, light heavyweight title against Bernard and Roy Jones Jr., respectively. Bernard had won that belt and recognition as the true champion at 175 by beating Antonio Tarver, who in turn had gotten it from Roy Jones before passing it back and forth with Glenn Johnson. So Joe was the linear champ in two divisions. I don't know if that's true. I thought that he may have went up, but I didn't think that that his titles, that the light heavyweight title, I don't ever remember him dropping his super middleweight title. If that's true, hey, good point. He says also, at that time, the ring belt actually meant something. It's a shame that that's gone by the wayside. You know, they really tried to bring that back, and even HBO was trying to help him because they were only referring to world championships from the ring. But, you know, when Golden Boy bought it, they promised they weren't going to, be biased, and that's all changed. He says also Kessler wasn't past his prime when they fought. He was a slight betting favorite and unbeaten at the time. Lacey was also heavily favored by the odds makers. Yeah, we mentioned that. The thing about Kessler is he's another fighter that I personally thought was a little overrated. But that's my opinion, you know. But yeah, I get it, and I respect your opinion. He says, speaking of super middleweights, I'm amazed at how big Frotch and Groves has become. I don't know if the fight can live up to it, to be honest, but with Carlin there, the odds of it being a dull fight must be slim. I agree, and I don't know why you don't think it's going to live up to it. You know, whether it goes whether it goes the distance or not, I think it's going to be an interesting fight. And listen, anytime you have a live fight in front of 80,000 people that are all jacked up for this fight, and, you know, who gets more jacked up than the Brits, man? For an all-British showdown, this could arguably be one of the, you know, down in history is one of the greatest British fights of all time, maybe. Who knows? So, yeah, I think that's a good bet. He says, who do you like in that fight? I've got Frotch, but by a mid-round stoppage, I see him throwing caution to the wind, getting out the heavy artillery and bludgeoning George into a corner and forcing the referee to intervene. I'm going to break down the fight and give my predictions tomorrow. But all I'm going to say is, you know, everybody makes it like that first fight was so controversial. It was a close fight. And, you know, I think there's more pressure actually on George Groves to make it a fight. Because if you're right, Hawaii Mike, and Carl Froch blows him away, the credibility of Groves is going to, you know, maybe get dropped down a peg or two. Remember, he had that fight with James DeGalley that many people think he lost, you know, so we'll have to wait and see. And he throws in a little jab. He says, P.S. sorry for the nobody here-esque email, which we all know nobody here likes to ramble on a little bit in his emails. But anyway, thanks for the email, Hawaii Mike. And my man Bajorn says, I had to explain to some younger guys the impact Mike Tyson had on the game. He was the hands-down baddest man on the planet. You did not think anyone could beat him because how he destroyed everyone. It's real different now. The fans talk about records and purses. The best now are rewarded for maneuvering their careers and making business decisions. Of course they love Floyd, but they didn't understand that at one point taking a Mike fight was like signing your own death warrant. We actually felt sorry for the other guy. And Bajorn makes an outrageously accurate statement here, and it's true. And that's the way it was. You know, Mike Tyson fights weren't just a Mike Tyson fight. It was an event. And it didn't matter if the fight lasted, you know, 12 rounds or 12 seconds. People went away from a Mike Tyson fight feeling very satisfied. You know, Mike Tyson did carry the sport on his back, did bring it back, so to speak. And when he left the sport, the sport kind of went into a lull and is currently in a resurgence. But the landscape has changed drastically, and Bajorn has described it perfectly. Today's young fan seems to think that a good, exciting fighter is one that's unbeaten. They also seem to think a good, exciting, you know, quality fighter is not only unbeaten, but he makes a lot of money. That's all great for a business point of view, but for the sport of boxing, it's leaving out a part of the sport that is so important to the sport. And it's hard to explain when everybody's so health and safety conscious today and politically correct and everything else. But the bottom line, no matter how you sugarcoat it, and no matter how you want to hide from it, boxing is a hurt sport. The whole idea of boxing is to render your opponent, and it's only you and your opponent, unconscious. You want to beat the crap out of him until he drops to the ground and they count him out. I mean, you want to sugarcoat it? You want to, you know, have referees stop it quickly? You want to hide behind the fighters that pitter-pat and run and don't get hit and you know, focus on that and not excitement? Well, hey, if that's what you're paying for and that's what you like, That's what you're going to get, because boxing has a tendency to give the people what they want. Well, unless your name is Floyd Mayweather and Manny Pacquiao is offered to you as an opponent.
Are you ready, America? Then let's get it on with Fight Now TV. It's time, fight fans. Your channel has arrived. All the fights, all the names, all the action. From world-class boxing events to mixed martial arts showdowns and other combat sports matchups, Fight Now TV delivers the hits and more. Call your television provider and tell them you want to get it on with Fight Now TV. For more details, go to fightnow.com.
Broadcasting in all corners of the globe,
on the web
and radio.
He would scoff at a stretch of that man, I would think.
You're listening to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. From upstate New York and the good old US of A.
Come and tell him Billy C sent ya.
Now back to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C, the only radio host man enough to take a punch from Mike Tyson.
Wait a minute, man. Hold on there. Jeremy, man, I need you to take this one, all right?
Wait, what? No way. I can't do this.
Need I remind you I'm Billy C, damn it? Now put on that mustache and get in there.
Hey, look at me. I'm Billy C. Crap.
The undisputed heavyweight champion of boxing talk radio. It's Talkin' Boxing with Billy C.
Test one, two. My fellow Americans, good evening. Welcome back to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. It's great to be here discussing the sweet science with everybody. I love boxing. I love talking boxing. It's what I do.
Bill.
Wait, what? Why are you interrupting me?
Wrong.
What's
wrong,
the problem?
Billy C.
I did not have...
We're going to have to ask
wrong
you
speech. What do you mean wrong, Billy C? What's going on here? Fine, I'll go. I just wanted to talk some boxing on TPSradio.net. That's all I wanted to do. I don't need your damn show. I'll get my own talking wrestling with the other Billy C. Yeah, that sounds good. Yeah. I've always been a Hulkamaniac anyway.
Our guest in live, brother. Welcome back to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C on the mighty TPSradio.net, brother. What you gonna do, brother?
And we're back. You're listening to the Talkin' Boxing with Billy C show. You're watching us on the Fight Now television channel. Glad you could join us. I want to welcome the Fight Now audience that's joining us live like they do every day at this time. And speaking of Fight Now audiences, you better call your cable provider and make sure you're still going to have Fight Now. That's all I can say. And speaking of Fight Now, well, speaking of now, my man, Larry Hazard joins us. What's up, brother?
Hey, Billy, how you doing, man?
Not too bad. Getting ready for the big week next week. When are you going to be heading up to the Hall of Fame?
Well, I'll probably get up there Saturday morning sometime.
Oh, you're going up on Saturday. You're not going to be up there before Saturday?
No, I'm not going to be able to get up there before Saturday. You know, I'm going to Saad Muhammad's funeral.
That's Friday.
Which is actually Thursday.
Oh, Thursday. I thought it was Friday, yeah.
No, it's going to be the 5th. It's in Philadelphia. So I'll be there, and then I have some other personal business that I had to push back. I have to take care of that on Friday. So I probably won't be able to get up there until around Saturday.
That's cool. That's going to be a fun time up there, that's for sure. Hopefully the weather will be nice, you know. Up there, weather could be anything. It could be freezing, it could be raining, it could be 100 degrees, hazy, hot, and humid. I mean, it's that time of year in upstate New York where you never know what you're going to get. But
It's usually pretty nice, though. I know last year was pretty nice. One year we had a little rain. You know, I've been going regularly since my induction in 2010. I think I missed 2011, but I picked up on it for the last couple of years. And the weather's been pretty nice.
Well, last year it rained a lot, I think.
It cleared up. It cleared up before the parade, though.
Right. Yeah, the parade. Yeah. You know, that's funny because I usually leave before Sunday. I usually leave on either Sunday morning or late Saturday. Because I'm the reverse. I like getting up there early before crazy stuff. But anyway, speaking of crazy stuff, this past weekend, Adonis Stevenson. Now, I know that we both like Kovalev and everything else, but Stevenson was always that other name that you threw around. And, you know, I don't know how to look at this fight other than, at my opinion, was that, you know, he took this guy lightly. You know, I know that it's not fair for me personally not to give Fonfara the credit. And as a matter of fact, it's not that I'm discrediting him. I still think he's a top 10 contender. We got him ranked at number 6 or 7, I believe. But I thought Stevenson was supposed to be way better, and I'm kind of leaning towards the idea that maybe he took Fonfara lightly. He seemed like he was huffing and puffing. He did eventually win. He came up off the canvas and won the fight the way champions do. But I did learn one thing. I said to myself, if I thought that he had a little bit of chance against Kovalev, now I think he has no chance against Kovalev. What's your thoughts on the fight itself first and the potential matchup with Sergey Kovalev hopefully someday?
Well, I was a bit disappointed in the fight because, as you can recall, when we had spoke last week, I really thought that this was a gift for Stevenson, Fonfara. I thought that it was really going to be a gift. I kind of think that Stevenson took him lightly, like you, and I really don't think Stevenson even trained that hard for the fight the way he looked. I mean, he came on toward the end, and I think that it just shows you and all the young fighters should get a lesson from what a good body attack will do. I think that he pulled it out toward the end, especially the last two rounds, with his body attack. But I think that he took his opponent, Fonfara. I think he took him lightly. I don't think that he trained properly. And, you know, it just goes to show that you just can't take anyone lightly in this game, you know, when you go in there, because if you're not in shape, you know, it's going to show. And he didn't appear to be in shape. He was huffing and puffing looking at that performance. And I think that Bernard would use his ring savvy on him, his ring intelligence, and I think he just might be able to con Stevenson into fighting the type of fight that he wants and end up, believe it or not, surprising everybody by winning in the end. But I don't think that there's anybody out there right now that stands much of a chance with Kovalev. The thing that I like about Kovalev is that he punches real straight. Shortest distance between two points is a straight line. And his punches come straight at you, and he seems to be always in good condition. And I just think that he's the best light heavyweight in the world. Even though I love Bernard Hopkins, but we know what Bernard's kind of down the way now, but you can never sell Bernard shortly. But I think Bernard is smart enough to also avoid Kovalev and go for Stevenson, because I think he really stands a good chance with Stevenson. But I don't think that Stevenson stands much of a chance with Kovalev either, especially after this performance last week.
Yeah, I agree with you 100%. You know, I too think that B-Hop can beat Stevenson. I think that you hit it right on the head. I think his ring savvy, he will get Stevenson to fall into his traps. He'll beat him mentally, and he'll use, you know, Bernard will fight, 75%, and he'll get the other 25% Stevenson fighting against himself, you know. So Bernard will get Stevenson to help Bernard win the fight, you know. So I agree with you there. Before I talk about, I got a question about body work I wanted to ask you. But, you know, I was saying that, and I agree that I think that Stevenson was not 100% focused on this fight. Do you think, and I've been kind of putting this question to everybody this week, and, you know, I can't help but point the finger at his new team and everything, and when I say Al Haymon, I'm not saying him just Al by himself, I'm just saying that new team. And they all seem to be the, not so much a rah-rah guy like we talk about and about the corner guys, you know, you gotta go hit him, go punch him, go, you know, avoid those shots, you know, not those kind of rah-rah guys, but the kind of guys that were around Mike Tyson in Tokyo, the guy that says you're a badass, you're this, you're that, you don't need a, he doesn't stand a chance against you, you know, and you start believing all of these accolades and slaps on the back. And I'm wondering if that whole circus that's, you know, now around Stevenson and all the PR and stuff that he's been doing and going here and going there, I'm wondering if that had anything to do with that performance as well. Do you think that there's a connection there, or do you just think he just didn't take Funfara seriously?
Well, Billy, you know, when you look at all of the goings on around a fighter, and then he comes up with a poor performance, certainly your first inclination is to believe that all of these things play into the performance. Certainly, when a fighter starts to read his own press clippings, as they say, and all of the cheerleaders around telling him how great he is, you know, that certainly will, over time, begin to play into his psyche, and he'll begin to think that he's greater than he really is, and that he doesn't need to train. Like that hunger begins to kind of fade, and he just feels that he's so superior to his opponents that he doesn't need to train like he did starting out. So I would have to say that probably so. You know, all of the negatives play in. If he performed well, then it would be easy to say, well, he's not listening to a lot of that stuff. But when he goes in and he doesn't perform well, and then he's beginning to have a history of these types of cheerleaders around him and, you know, all of the stuff that goes on that has nothing whatsoever to do with fighting, really, you know, you have to feel that it's having an effect on him. And maybe he'll wise up and, you know, turn the corner and go in a different direction. But yeah. I believe that it does play in, and it has to be a factor.
Yeah, you're right. You know, if the performance was, you know, a normal performance, nobody even overanalyzes it. Nobody even says, oh, it was because of this, this, and the other thing. Everybody just says, see, it was a normal performance. You made an interesting point about the body work, and I agree with you 100%. And my technical question for you is really, I guess there's no real correct answer. I'm just looking for your opinion. But in that fight, and the body work was so effective, and when he turned to it and really just, you know, went all out and just focused on an all-out assault to the body, we all saw that it changed the complexion of the fight and basically secured the win. My question is that why do fighters avoid the body work these days, Larry? I mean, you know, we talk about how a fighter breaks his opponent down, and you go through the history of the sport, and you see that a body attack was so instrumental in achieving that. And it just seems that a lot of fighters have abandoned it, and even the ones that use it don't give it enough time. I've always said you can't work on a body one round. You really got to sustain a body attack for 4 or 5 rounds before it starts paying you dividends. At least that's what I think. What's your thoughts on that?
Well, the body attack pays dividends when you mix a good body attack in with head work, you know, throughout the whole fight. You know, because all of the accumulation of punches to the head and to the body eventually take an effect on the fighter. Head punches usually causes a concussion. The body work usually weakens the legs and the lower extremities. So that body work becomes very crucial in breaking a fighter down and slowing him up. You know, takes his legs away. I think what fighters like so much about scoring punches to the head is because it draws the big roar from the crowd, it has the drama, and it's more visible. You know, it appears that it's more dramatic, a good combination to the head. But a real fight person, a real good trainers, people who really know the anatomy of a fight, they know the real effect of body work. And that's another thing that I think is lacking in the judging of fights. A lot of judges, they get mesmerized with head blows, and they don't give fighters enough credit also for the body work. A good body shot somehow doesn't seem to be worth as much as a good shot to the head, which it is. You know, and I think that there should be a greater emphasis, even in judging about that, more credit should be given for the body work. But I think that fighters overall get mesmerized by, you know, punching to the head and scoring good punches to the face, because the crowd, it brings that roar from the crowd, and it makes them feel psychologically that they're winning the fight because they're scoring punches to the head. But a real good fighter, if you look at all the good fighters, past and present, especially the great fighters from yesteryear, you know, many of them focused a lot on the body, and then they shift their attack to the head, and then, you know, they scored a lot of knockouts in that way because they break down the entire, you know, the entire body of the opponent. So mixing the body and the head is the most effective in anybody in the attack, when, you know, in a bout. And I think that there should be more emphasis placed on that, especially when you're starting out the amateurs, when the kids, you know, the trainers should teach that more in the amateur ranks, and then, you know, the young fighters will kind of internalize that as they develop through the years into the professional ranks.
I agree with you, and I also agree that a lot of the judges out there are not giving these fighters that focus on the body enough credit. And with all that said, like my man Alex Papali made a point yesterday on the show, I guess we really got to give Andre Funfara a lot of credit for surviving, because, you know, this is a guy that was visibly hurt from those body shots on several occasions, and I don't know how many times a fighter can actually survive it when you're that hurt. Usually when you go down from a body shot or close to going down, it's not much longer after that where the fight is over, and he kind of stayed in there, and he showed us that he at least has some heart. He's the kind of fighter that you kind of want to see again, you know?
Well, it's also a tribute to his physical conditioning, okay?
Exactly.
You know, you can't sell him short. You know, good physical conditioning, okay, I think was his savior there, okay? He appeared to be in good condition, taking those body shots. And also, you know, Julio Cesar Chavez is proof positive, you know, with that left hook to the liver that he became so famous for. You know, it's pretty hard to survive those shots. And Funfara was taking a lot of, you know, punishing shots to the body, but he managed to survive it, and I think that that's a tribute to his good physical conditioning, which, you know, tells you that this guy was in good shape.
Yeah, and
doing those calisthenics, doing those sit-ups, and whatever other exercises that are designed to condition the body.
And he was a tall guy with a lot of body to hit too. So you give him credit there. Hey,
a lot of target.
Yeah, man. Yeah. I'm going to ask you about the big fight this weekend. Before that, I know that we've discussed your approvement of these tournaments that just wrapped up. ESPN did the Boxino tournament. They crowned their middleweight and lightweight champion. Do you have any final thoughts on that tournament and how it went? And I mean, I for one thought it was extremely entertaining right from the get-go, from the first fight all the way to the finals. I really enjoyed it. I hope they do it again. What's your final thoughts on that specific tournament, and would you like to see more like it?
Oh, I love to, Billy. You know, I'm a big fan of those types of innovative types of things in boxing. I think it was very innovative. I thought that it was a very successful tournament. I think it gave exposure to a lot of young upcoming fighters who otherwise would not have gotten that type of exposure, and I think it was a great success. I'd like to see more of those types of tournaments. You know, you've heard me say in the past, I would like to see state championships. I'd like to see those types of tournaments that will showcase some of the up-and-coming talent, you know, because the talent is there. Instead of, you know, all the upper echelon always gets the focus on HBO and Showtime and all the other, you know, other networks. I think that ESPN did a fantastic job with that tournament, and I'd like to see them do more of it.
Yeah, I hope so. And I think they did well enough, you know, at the venue and you know, with the fighters. I can't see why they wouldn't do it again. I really don't. But this weekend we have a couple of big fights. Before I get to the biggest fight, I wanted to ask you your thoughts on a couple of the other smaller ones that are surrounding it. Nonito Donaire is a fighter that I got to be honest. You know, I think he's been brilliantly matched. You know, he's always seemingly fighting smaller or older guys and stuff. And at times he's exciting. But if he's in there with a guy that's got some boxing ability, it seems to have trouble. Like if you don't, you know, let him hit you with his power punch, you know, he doesn't seem to know what to do. He's moving up again in weight, and he's taking on Simpui Vatikia, I think is how you say his last name. Do you see him having any trouble with this kid? I mean, this kid is a champion. He has won a couple of tough fights, but realistically, he hasn't been in with that high of a level of opponent. Do you think this is just a showcase fight for Donaire, or do you think it's going to be an actual challenge for him?
No, I think it's another showcase. You know, Donaire, you know, like you said, they seem to be cherry-picking for him all the time, and I don't see any difference in this fight. I don't think he's going to have much difficulty with this particular fight.
You know, Victor Chinian is a fighter that I've always liked. I love his nasty. For a little fighter, you know, he's got this nasty little attitude, and he wants to get the job done. And he's been around a long time. You know, I broke down the fight and was doing some research. I was shocked to see that he's 38 already, and he's stepping in with an unknown guy, at least unknown to most people, in Nicholas Walters. He happens to be a champion of the WBA. But this kid is the real deal. But he has never faced anybody like Darchinian. Darchinian's coming off a knockout loss to Nonito Donaire. Do you think Darchinian has one more win, one more title in him, or do you think his days are gone and this will be a showcase, let's meet Nicholas Walters type fight?
Well, I think Darchinian is going to have trouble here. You know, I remember when Gary Shaw had Darchinian. Those were his best years, I believe. And I don't think Shaw has him anymore, which tells most of the story about, you know, what you can expect from him. But I think that Darchinian has seen his better days, and I think that he might be in for, you know, a tough outing here. You know, I think this is going to be a showcase for the other guy, you know. And Darchinian's the name, you know, the notch for this kid coming along. So we'll see what happens. But I think Darchinian's pretty much at the end of his career at this point.
The big fight of the weekend, the one that everybody's talking, biggest money guy, Floyd Mayweather himself, did not sell out in his last fight. They had 15,000 people there. They had almost 250 tickets available. And the point made was that Manny Pacquiao, because he fought at Dallas Cowboys Stadium, actually has been the biggest U.S. Live gate draw in the last 40 years. You know, he had 40,000 people, almost 50 at the one fight with Claudio. And the Carl Froch fight with George Groves sold out. 80,000 people are going to be there live. What's your thoughts on number one, the support from the live gate, and number two, the fight itself between Froch and George Groves?
Well, first, the live gate. Let me tell you, I was down at Dallas Stadium when Pacquiao fought Claudio, and that place was packed, man. And it's a beautiful place. You know, and it's a rarity. It's really a rarity in America. You know, we haven't, years ago, you know, they used to have fights in Chicago Stadium, you know, Yankee Stadium, you know, and 50, 60,000 fans. You know, you don't see that anymore. You know, you see 14, 15,000 fans in a stadium now in Vegas. You know, it's like, wow, a lot of people, you know. But when you go overseas, you know, I've been all in Germany. You should see Germany and Poland. You should see how they pack the people in. Galata. I remember Galata when he fought Adamek in Poland. They had to have maybe 50, 60,000 people in that place, you know. And Germany and some of those foreign countries, even in South Africa, you know, they pack those. I mean, it's unheard of numbers of people, you know, and compared to the United States. You know, we're way behind. We're light years behind in fan support, you know, live fan support. As far as that fight is concerned, you know, this has been a very controversial. You remember the first fight? It was very controversial. I kind of lean toward Frock in this fight, Billy. I just feel that Frock is really revved up, and I kind of lean. I wouldn't be surprised if Frock doesn't stop Grove in this fight. You know, he's a tough. You know, Frock's a real hard, tough guy, and if he brings his best game, I think that he's going to come out the winner, even by a technical knockout.
Yeah, you know, Frotch is when you really look at his record, almost for the last 10 years, I have some notes on it. It might be the last 6 or 7. He's fought nothing less than world class or championship caliber fighters.
That's all he fights.
That's it. You know, I mean, you know, we talk about, you know, fighting the best available, and you know, we criticize other fighters for, you know, cherry picking opponents. Whether you like Carl Froch or not, you can't say he's doing that, because you know, he's fought the best of the best in his division. And you know, my only hang up with Froch is, you know, the guy fights with his hands down, you know, and it's just something that irks me. I think fighters need to be technically sound, you know, and they get away with their athleticism until Father Time catches up with him, and we all know he catches up with all of us, you know. So
yeah, well, he's certainly not, you know. Roy Jones used to like to fight with his hands down a lot, okay. But Roy was very, you know, Roy had that athleticism, and he had those, you know, good reflexes, and he was much younger too when he was really at the top of his game. But Frotch, as you say, you know, he doesn't have the type of skills of a Roy Jones or some of the other guys that fought with their hands down a lot. So he has to be careful. But he's a tough, you know, he's a tough guy, and he's always fought the toughest guys out there. So, you know, I can't take anything away from him. You know what I mean?
No,
I have to grow with Frotch in this fight.
I agree with you. I agree. He's a quality fighter. Hey, listen, Larry. We're not gonna be doing the show next week. I'll be up at the Hall of Fame, and I'll see you up there. And we can't wait to have you part of our big event up there on Saturday. And then the following week, we're actually doing something in Tampa. So we'll have you back on in 2 weeks.
Okay, very good, Billy.
All right, man. So I'll see you up next week, my man. I'm looking forward to it.
Okay, I'll see you next week. I'll be there.
All right, my man. Take care.
Okay.
That's Hall of Famer Larry Hazard giving us his thoughts. I got to take a break. I'll be back in 2.
Talk and Boxing with Billy C now has official merchandise available on talkandboxing.com. T-shirts, sweatshirts, hoodies, and mugs. And yes, even undergarments. Talk and Boxing apparel is the perfect gift for the boxing fan in your life. Log on to www.talkinboxing.com. That's TalkinBoxing.com. And place your order today.
Join us here for 2 hours as Billy and the gang do what they do best.
Every time I start talking about boxing, a white man got to pull Rocky Marciano out his ass. Rocky Marciano was good, but compared to Joe Louis, Rocky Marciano ain't.
It's Joe Louis' ass.
Joe Louis was 75 years old when he fought.
Huh? What?
We're supposed to be talking boxing.
It's Talking Boxing with Billy C.
As Billy C sits here
in the multi-million-dollar Talkin' Boxing Studios, sipping a fine wine before you're even out of bed, you should be thinking, damn, I wish I had a mustache like his. It's the Talkin'
Ordinary People. We're morons.
Anything else?
I'm a victim of circumstance.
Did your success finally come when you made the show 5 days a week for 2 hours? What do you think?
I'm trying to think, but nothing happens.
Now, please tell the listeners what you've learned from making it this far.
Certainly. If it wastes you don't succeed, keep on sucking till you do succeed.
Great words of wisdom, Billy C. Keep up the great work as the undisputed People's Champion with your show, Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. Any last words to anyone who's listening?
This is your fault, you bonehead.
And we're back. You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C Show. You're watching us on the Fight Now television channel. Glad you could join us. And if you don't have Fight Now in your sports channel lineup, you need to call your local television provider and tell them that you want Fight Now right now. And right now is a good time to do it, too. All the information about the channel can be found on their website, www.fightnow.com. And speaking of now, we'll wait for Dax to give us a shout. He is scheduled to come on. But I got one more email. This is from Busta from South Florida. He says, hey, Billy C., what's your thoughts on the continued talk from Bob Arum, Todd DeBoeuf of Top Rank about making a Pacquiao-Canelo fight? Realistically, is this possible? Why is it that Al Heyman has managed to sign almost all the big names except Canelo? Because in my opinion, Canelo is a top three pay-per-view draw currently and a top two in the coming future. It seems like he could probably get Canelo even more money as he has shown he can do with other big names. Why has he not gone after Canelo? Please discuss. Well, I'll give you one reason. Oscar De La Hoya. Saul Canelo Alvarez, his loyalty is with Oscar De La Hoya. He made no qualms about that. And I really respect him for that. You know, and I respect him for, you know, seeking out the toughest fights and everything else. I was never anti Saul Canelo Alvarez, but I was never a real big fan until I saw his loyalty towards Oscar De La Hoya and also until I saw his desire to fight only the best fighter. So that's why I think, and I'm just curious to know, I will admit that Canelo most likely will be that next pay-per-view guy, you know, after Manny Pacquiao and Floyd retire. We know we got maybe 2 years left of each of those guys. But who would be the next one? Who would be the next pay-per-view guy? Who is going to be the next pay-per-view draw in boxing? That's going to be curious to find out. Anyway, right now joining us is my man Dax Khan with his weekend boxing schedule roundup. What's up, Dax?
Hey, what's going on, everybody?
Not too much. Getting ready for the Hall of Fame. Enjoying a day of nice weather. We're supposed to get rain again starting tomorrow for the rest of the week, but for the weekend. But anyway, give us your weekend boxing schedule roundup.
All right, before we start, you got an echo back there?
No, it's me going.
I have an echo in my voice over here. That's why. Well, I just wanted to make sure it wasn't going on there too.
Nope, you sound fine.
All right, starting Friday on the 30th in Germany, ULF Steinfurth, Francesco Pinata takes on Michael Vieira for the vacant WBO European Heavyweight title in Accra, Ghana. Golden Mike Promotions will have a female featherweight bout between Helen Joseph and Melissa Hernandez for the vacant IBF female featherweight title. In Russia, former WBA world champion Alexander Povetkin takes on former title challenger Manuel Char for the vacant WBC international heavyweight title, both with former Klitschko victims, of course. And on the undercard, Rakim Shakiv faces Brymo Kamokov in a cruiserweight contest in Germany on Saturday. Sternbox has a rematch between Felix Sturm and Sam Solomon for Sturm's IBF middleweight title. In Macau, SAR China on HBO2, Top Rank will present Nicholas Waters and former multi-division world champion Victor Chinian in the main event for the WBA world featherweight title. The co-feature will be Simpawi Vetyeka going against Nonito Danier. Vetyeka's WBA Super World Featherweight title will be on the line there as well. Yuvina Gradovich defends his IBF Featherweight title against Alexander Miskirkian. In Mexico, on a Del Pueblo promoted card, Sariskis Sorung Visa will defend his WBC Super Flyweight title against unbeaten power puncher Carlos Quadras. In Poland, Marcin Rakowski and Albert Sosnowski will meet in a heavyweight bout. At Wembley Stadium in London on HBO and Sky TV, the rematch everybody's been waiting for, Carl Froch and George Groves will fight. Look for retribution and bragging rights between the two of them. The IBF and WBA super middleweight titles will be online. Kevin Mitchell and Hislam Aduma face off in the lightweight contest. James DeGalley faces Brandon Gonzalez in the super middleweight affair. And Jamie McDonald and Tab Tim Dang. Now, Ratchawat will go at it for the vacant WBA World Bantamweight title. Former Olympian Anthony Joshua will also be in action. Great card for Matchroom Boxing. Mohegan Sun Casino in Lucasville, Connecticut. Hank Lundy will be in action against Gerardo Cuevas. Also, Shelly Salido's Way is going to be scheduled for about there. In New Jersey, Alex Perez will be facing Jeremiah Wiggins in a welterweight contest. At the Tropicana Hotel and Casino in Las Vegas, DiBello and Samson Boxing team up for a card. Undefeated featherweight Javier Fortuna takes on Juan Antonio Rodriguez in the main event. Luis Orlandito Davali meets Luis Rosa in a super bantamweight contest. And former world title holder Sergio Moro will be on the card against Samuel Rogers. And last one for this week will be on Sunday in Russia when Dmitry Shudinov and Patrick Nielsen meet for the interim WBA World Middleweight title. And Anna-Laure Esteche will defend her female light welterweight title against Svetlana Kulikova.
Good deal. You know, we talked a little about the Stevenson fight already, right? Did you call in with that, or do you have some thoughts on the Adonis Stevenson?
Yeah, we did. We talked about that. As a matter of fact, I was actually on the main events conference call today for their upcoming card with their light heavyweights on June 21st. And I was talking to, Kathy Duva, and I was talking to also to trainer Jesse Reed. About, state of the heavyweight division. And believe it or not, I think it was Jesse Reed Sr., he said he called Adonis Stevenson an over a hyped-up club fighter who was exposed last week. And also, nobody's impressed with them at all. And in that fight, Bill, pretty much all the everything that Adonis Stevenson has built up as like...
The thing is this... I agree with what you and I had talked about previously about Stevenson and, maybe he was out of shape, maybe he didn't take the fight seriously, all these things. Larry gave some points just a few minutes ago, and I agree with all those things. And as much as I agree that he's not the best light heavyweight, I think Kovalev is, I even think B-Hop will beat Stevenson and all these things. But what kind of makes me laugh, what you just said, and the way the nature of boxing today in this whole new generation of fans, you lose a fight and the word exposed comes out, more than at a peep show convention, I mean, the word exposed, he's overrated, he's this, he's that, he's, he's a bum, he's a... I mean, is that really fair? I can think what I want about Stevenson and agree with everything you said, that maybe he wasn't all that. Maybe he, he was in the right place at the right time. But is it really fair to label a fighter as being exposed or washed up or done after one poor performance?
No, no. And those weren't just my my comments.
I know.
I'm just saying stuck to that scene, around social media that's just been going around the rumor mill.
I know that it wasn't yours. I'm just saying today's young fan, I mean, what's your thoughts on that attitude is my point.
Right. What I was going to say is, it is unfair, but, because that is the way it just seems to be, is just the fact that, one bad performance and everybody calls somebody, the overrated, they were exposed and stuff like that. I think it's really unfair when you get guys that go out there and they're fighting 7, 8 great fights against top-level competition, and then, you know, they go against somebody who might not be that top level, let's say, you know, a mandatory defense or something like that, and they don't do that great of a job, you know, they do enough to win, then all of a sudden, you know, not only are they exposed, but every other person that they beat, no matter how good they, you know, how good they were up until the time they lost to that fighter, they were exposed too. All of a sudden, now you have a whole division of guys that are just no good. So, yeah, it's like, you can't win for losing, or, you know, even if you lose, you can't win, no matter how you want to put it.
Well, you know, again, I think a lot of the blame has to be, you know, distributed among the sanctioning bodies and the promoters and the networks, because, you know, those are the three groups that feed the large pool of, you know, mediocrity. You know, I mean, these fighters that have no business being a champion, or even quite frankly a top contender, you know, they find themselves as a mandatory, and then, you know, the fighter is forced to fight them to keep their belt, the promoter is forced to put the fight on, the network puts it on because the mandatory has a good looking record, and the fans, you know, they blame the fighter for cherry picking, or they, you know, should he lose, they blame the fighter for being exposed. So I mean, it's all relative. It's like, you know, borrowing and borrowing and borrowing, and then all of a sudden you got to pay somebody back at some point. You know what I mean? And I think maybe that's what's going on right now. You know, the sport has been floating along, and people making good moves by maneuvering their fighters in a certain way that makes it come out good. And all of a sudden now you got to pay the piper. And if a guy like Adonis Stevenson, you know, struggled with Andre Fonfara, who, in all fairness to him, you know, I wasn't giving him any chance. I figured he shouldn't even be being overrated. You know, it's like, who knows? But listen,
yeah, you can't tell. That's what I mean. You can't tell. You know what I mean? Maybe he's just been so underrated because he hasn't had the opportunity, or maybe Stevenson is overrated because he's only got, you know, he fought these guys at the right point in time. It really is hard. That's why, you know, as you always say, and we talk about here on the show all the time, good matchmaking is what tells you, you know what I mean? Good matchmaking is going to tell you more about a fighter than anything, yeah. More than knockout wins are going to do.
And just beating one good fighter doesn't mean that you're ready. You know, you got to show that you're consistent. At least that's the way it was. Hey, listen, there's some decent fights on the schedule this week. And I don't know, I thought there was a lot of tough picks for myself. I want to start off with a fighter you're awfully familiar with. Luis de Valle is taking on Luis Rosa in what I think is a really hard fight to pick. What's your thoughts on this fight, and who's going to win?
It is a hard fight. It's a good fight, and it's one of those fights that exactly that fits the criteria we were just saying, good matchmaking. You know, Orlando De Valle, you know, who trained and started out, you know, from the area where I am, he had a lot of soft opponents. As he started getting better, when he got in there with Victor Chinian for the first time, you know, the veteran gave him a lot of problems. His corner didn't help him make any of the adjustments. You know, he was basically out there floating in the wind by himself. Matter of fact, Alex Pierpoli and I were ringside for that. Now that Lewis has a new promotion company, he has a new trainer underneath him. You know, he's being brought up little by little. And this is the type of fight, you know, that's going to test him. But, you know, it's not a fight that's in too tough with him because, you know, the kid is very skilled. He's a good boxer. And he's not the puncher that, you know, his record makes it look like, but, you know, he does have some pop. So, you know, I'm going to go with Orlando De Valle on this one. You know, it's going to be a close fight, but, you know, I expect him to win by a decision.
In the heavyweight division, another interesting fight, Manuel Char, who seems to, you know, have been placed in this heavyweight picture ever since his loss to Klitschko, and he's got some wins after that, and he's up against a guy that was actually a former world champion, someone that I think, quite honestly, I don't know how else to put it, but I thought he was an underachiever in Alex Povetkin. How do you see this one going?
You know, it's a toss-up. It really is. You know, Manuel Char, he's not a big puncher. I mean, he's not a feather-fisted by any chance either. You know, he has a few good wins, you know, and Kevin Johnson, you know, he outboxed him pretty steadily. I think before that, he fought Denis Bakatov. You know, he's most known, obviously, for his TKO loss to Klitschko. But, you know, he's a guy that, you know, has never really been into, you know, too many big fights other than the Klitschko fight. So being at home, you know, where fighting, you know, at home where Povetkin is, unless he scores a knockout, I don't see how he's going to win. As far as, you know, Povetkin goes, who knows what kind of mental, you know, what kind of mental damage is left after, you know, the one-sided and pretty much embarrassing loss that he received by, you know, Vladimir Klitschko. As you said, he, you know, he never really seemed like a guy that was really that into it. He was an underachiever, so, you know, that kind of tells us, you know, where's his head? Is he the type of guy that can bounce back from a loss? And, you know, if he goes in there against Char and he's not having his way, is he going to get discouraged and he's going to be out, is he going to, you know, just get outboxed? I don't know. I would call it a toss-up, you know, if it was on neutral ground, but I'd have to give it to Povetkin because he is fighting at home and, you know, all the close rounds are more than likely going to go in his favor. So I think Povetkin's going to win this one by decision.
What's a tough fight on paper, and which is going to be a important fight for the division, James DeGalley against Brendan Gonzalez. I'm really interested in this fight. I this is a fight that I hope I get to see from a stream or something. But it's interesting because they're both kind of ranked around the same place. And, you know, I don't know what to think of Brendan Gonzalez. There's always been a lot of fanfare around him and a lot of accolades. And I see a lot of blemishes with him in terms of his whole skill set package. What's your thoughts on this fight, and how do you see it going?
DeGalley's definitely been in there with the better guys. You know, he holds wins over, you know, Dia Davis, Fulgencio Zanugo, who, you know, who's been in there with everybody. You know he's lost all his big fights. You know, he's been in there with George Groves, who's fighting this weekend. You know, he lost a close fight with George Groves. He definitely has the experience. He does have a little bit of pop. That you know, they are fighting at home, stuff like that. As for Gonzalez, you know, I've seen him fight a few times, but, you know, I don't know really that much about him. His opponents, other than the Thomas Oosthuizen fight, you know, I don't really think that he's had a signature win. So I'm going to have to say that DeGalley wins this one. I think DeGalley's actually going to knock him out at home because DeGalley's hungry and he wants another title shot.
A fight, another tough one. You know, it's tough because if you really dissect the two resumes, you see that they're very similar. And Javier Fortuna against Juan Antonio Rodriguez. Rodriguez is not known here in the States, but he has faced a very similar opposition, if not better opposition than Fortuna. How do you see this one going?
I like Javier Fortuna. You know, I've seen him fight a few times. He beat Patrick Hyland. You know, Patrick used to train right over by me as well. But like you said, he, other than, you know, and Patrick, you know, his resume was kind of weak too. You know, and he has had the interim title, but, you know, other than that, really, he has no signature names on there. I definitely agree that Rodriguez has the better resume. And he's, you know, he's a more exciting fighter. He's the harder hitter. And, you know, I'm going to have to say that, you know, Rodriguez is going to knock Fortuna out, in my opinion. I don't think Javier Fortuna is ready for this.
Yeah.
I think he's a guy that, you know, he's looked good because he's been matched right. Not that he's a bad fighter, but I think, you know, he's had a lot of proper matchmaking, you know, to get him where he is.
Yeah, no, it was a tough one for me, too. Nonito Donaire against Simpiwe Vitika. I don't know what to think of this fight. Vitika looks like he's not a bad fighter, and he's a bigger fighter, and he's been bigger longer. And Donaire, I think, has been, talk about matched correctly. It showed me when he fought Omar Navarez, it showed me that unless you let him knock you out, in other words, stand right in front of him, he's one-dimensional. And, you know, in his last fight against Rigondeaux, Rigondeaux schooled him. You know, I'm not saying Vitika is a Rigondeaux, but what's your thoughts on this fight?
And on top of that, you know, in the rematch with Victor Kinyon, he should have done a lot better. Yeah, he won, but, you know, it took him 9 rounds to get Vic out of there. As far as the Narvaez fight, I said it even back then, Narvaez is a better fighter than Donaire is overall. It's just Donaire was so much bigger and so much stronger than Narvaez was, you know, and, you know, and Narvaez went the distance, and that's the only loss on Narvaez's career. I also, when I seen this fight signed, I thought it was a big mistake because Donaire doesn't seem to have that desire anymore. He was walking through a lot of guys, you know, fairly easily. You know, some of them were battle-worn. You know, he had a lot of guys that he had the size advantage of, or, you know, they were coming off losses within the last couple fights before then. So I'm really going to call, you know, I'm going to say that Vetiakov gets the upset in this, and I think he's actually going to knock Donaire out.
Wow. That would be... I tell you the truth, I'd like to see that. in a fight that I'm really curious about, and I'm actually curious to see how the guys in the challenge go, but you mentioned Victor Chinian. Well, he's back, and he's taking on Nicholas Walters, and he's actually getting another shot at a title. Nicholas Walters has the WBA belt, and Walters hasn't really fought that tough of opposition. He's virtually unknown here in the States. Is Vic going to win a title, or is Vic going to get another back-to-back loss situation?
Vic is a guy that every time, you know, we think he's done, you know, he comes back, and even if he loses, he looks good. You know, for example, when he fought Abner Maris, everybody thought that Maris was going to walk over him, and, you know, he lost by split decision, and then right after that, he went and beat Yanni Perez. You know, he had his back-to-back losses to Moreno and I think Yamanaka, and then he came back to win two. And even though he lost to Donaire the last time out, I don't think he really did that bad against Donaire. He just, you know, he just kind of faded down the stretch. But this is really a toss-up fight. You know, I can't. It's hard for me to pick. With my heart, I want to say Vic. You know, because I'm a big Vic Darchinian fan.
Yeah, me too.
But you know, again, it depends on which version of Vic does show up. But you know, again, as far as Nicholas Walters goes, he hasn't really fought too many tough guys. If you look at, you know, his last six fights, even, you know, nobody really stands out on there. Not even Darius Prescott or Garza. You know, he won the fight with the title, the vacant title, when he fought Prescott. And, you know, Garza, you know, is not really that well known. I don't know that much about him anyway. And before that, you know, he's fought a lot of guys at, you know, B level. So, you know, I'm going to go with Vic. You know, I might be wrong, but I'm going to go with my heart. I'm going to say Vic only due to experience. And the one thing that Vic always has is he has that awkward, you know, herky-jerky style that unless you've really been in there with top-level guys, it can be very hard to figure out.
Like you, I'm a big Vic Darchinian fan, and I love the guy. You know, a mean little guy. There's nothing better than that. You know, that's what I like so much. Giovanni Segura. You know, I loved him, and like King Kong Igbeko. You know, these little guys that just, you know, they're like the Tasmanian devil. You know, but
exactly. You know, you hear about the guys that they say the little man complex. You know, because they're small, they want to start the fights with the bigger guys. But like you said, Vic is just a mean little guy. He doesn't care if you're smaller than him, if you're bigger than him, you're the same size as him. Vic just wants to go in there toe to toe, and he wants to fight. I mean, he is the true definition of a fighter. You know, Vic will fight any point and any time, whether there's a belt on the line, whether there's not, and he's going to give it his all. You know, he goes out there, you know, and it's all about the thrill of the win. For him, you know, how can you not like Vic Darchinian?
It's like dogs, you know, those little teeny dogs that women carry around, and they're always looking at you shaking, and you're like, what a pathetic little dog. And then all of a sudden you put that little dog near a big dog, and that little dog starts kicking the crap out of the big dog. Makes you wonder. He's got the big dog running away like the mini dog's packing a machine gun or something, you know. It's like, what's up with that, you scared little rat? You know, I mean, what are you scared?
Or you ever see this one, and not to interrupt you, but on TV you'll see somebody got bit in the face because somebody's holding one of them little lap dogs and they're leaning over, somebody's trying to stick their face in and go, oh, what a cute little, and the thing bites its nose off.
Yeah, those little dogs you got to watch out for. But anyway, the big fight of the weekend, Carl Froch against George Groves. It's a rematch. The first one was somewhat controversial. I have my opinions about that. But the truth of the matter is 80,000 people are going to be live in that arena. This is a huge fight, not only for British boxing, but for boxing worldwide. We're going to be watching it on HBO here in the States. I love the fight. I love both of the fighters. It's a tough one to pick. Who do you like?
You know, Carl Froch is another guy like Vic. You know, he's hard not to like. You know, everything about him as a fighter is what you want. I think the last time out, I think maybe Froch might have underestimated Groves a little bit. The thing with Carl Froch, and he's always proven this, you know, just when you think he's hurt and you think you got him, you know, that's when, you know, all of a sudden Carl comes back and puts on his best work. As a matter of fact, that's how me and you met, was at the Jermaine Taylor fight, when, you know, Jermaine was really up on him, and then all of a sudden Carl came back out of nowhere. And what I think also, too, is that George Groves, I don't know, you know, if he just felt offended, whether or not he's mad that the stoppage happened, you know, or Carl's managed to get under his skin with some comments, but, you know, he feels he was really shorted in that fight, you know, about the stoppage being premature, and, you know, and so he's going to go in there, and I think he's going to make a lot of mistakes. He's going to go in there looking to take Carl's head off, but, you know, he hasn't been to the places Carl has been. Froch has been, you know, in this spot so many times, so I just think, you know, between the fact that Carl was inside his head, between, you know, as big as this event it is, not only over there in the UK, but around the world, you know, I think, you know, that Groves is going to wilt underneath the stage, and I think Carl's going to put on a clinic. You know, Groves is going to come out, he's going to do good early on, but after the third round, Froch is going to take over, and I think he's going to knock him out. But this time, he's going to make sure he does it definitively, so this way there is no way anybody can complain afterwards.
Yeah, no, good point. Dax, great job as usual, and same thing as I told Larry, I'll be seeing you up at the Hall of Fame next week, and we'll have you back here doing your segment in 2 weeks, because we'll be doing the event in Tampa the following week after that. So we got some busy stuff going on, and we'll be talking to you here on the show in a couple of weeks, and I'll probably be talking to you tomorrow morning, but I'll see you up at the Hall of Fame.
Hey, I'm looking forward to it. We got a lot of fun up there, so hope we get to see people. Have a good weekend, everybody.
All right, brother. Take care. That's Dax Khan, and you can check out Dax Khan every Thursday here. He's also got the column on BillyCBoxing.com. And don't forget, next week up at the International Boxing Hall of Fame, we're going to be doing an event of all events. It's taking place on Saturday, right outside Graziano's. There's going to be tents set up. There'll be chairs for a live audience. We're going to be doing a marathon broadcast. That's right, a marathon broadcast. We're going to be starting around 2 p.m. Eastern, and we're going to go until around 2 a.m. Eastern. So if you're up there at the Hall of Fame, make sure you stop by, say hello, come on the air. We're going to be broadcasting it. And if you're not up there, all you got to do is tune in to LDLTV.com.
Talking Boxing with Billy C. Every week, 2 hours of the best boxing talk on the radio.
I have a bunch of questions, Donnell, right? If you feel like you want to, you can answer for J.D. first. Why will you win? J.D. Chapman, why will you win?
Baby Holmes will get sick and get hit by a train that day on the way to the title. He might have diarrhea, he might have the flu, he might throw up. One of his eyeballs might fall out that day, and I might get lucky.
Talking Boxing with Billy C. If you want your voice heard on Talking Boxing with Billy C, then call our hotline at 845-228-8710. Leave a voicemail. Or you could just tell Billy C that you like his mustache.
Should I ask you your opinion about this idea?
I'm just trying to give you the encouragement.
Listen, all I need from you is to make sure you don't hang up on people.
And if we like your call, we'll play it back on the air.
Billy, you have the knowledge and wisdom of boxing because of what you do and how well you do it.
Leave your name, hometown, and what you think of the show. 845-228-8710. We want to hear you.
Hey, fight fans, check out KOFantasyBoxing.com. KO Fantasy Boxing is boxing's only trademarked fantasy game. Check it out, www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. Select your own gym, your own fighters, track them through a season that can last from 3 months to a year, depending upon which league you join. You got to check this out, man. www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. Join it today. Again, www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. And tell them Billy C sent ya.
The one, the only, Don King.
Makes me feel good, Billy, to have you, the number one show in the country, talking boxing with Billy. So I invite each and every American that's listening to this great show to tune in, because we want you to be there with Billy and me.
Now back to Talking Boxing with Billy C. He may not have an Excellence in Broadcasting Award, but the night's still young. So you never know what may be by morning. It's Talking Boxing with Billy C.
Talking Boxing with Billy C.
And shabab that wah. We're back. You're listening to the Talking Boxing on Billy C Show. You're watching us on the Fight Now television channel. Glad you could join us. And speaking of the Fight Now channel, hey, man, you know, if you've been listening to everybody in the chat room bragging about the Fight Now connection and all that stuff and the picture and the viewing experience and all that, well, now's the time, man. There's a lot of moves going on with the channel, and now's the time for you to call your TV provider, especially if it's Dish Network, because if your TV provider is Dish Network, the satellite, then we're real close to getting on Dish. So anything that you can do to call and demand the Fight Now channel and the Talking Boxing with Billy C Show will expedite that. And wouldn't you like to watch it on Dish Network rather than the stream that constantly goes down? But hey, even if you don't have Dish, if you have DirecTV, or if you have any of the major cable providers, make sure you call and demand the Fight Now channel. The sooner the better. And if you could take a minute and let me know where you're from and who you contacted, that would be even better. Just drop me an email, Billy at Talkin' Boxing. That's TalkinBoxing.com. Phone lines is open. We may be able to take a call or two if you feel that you want to talk about something, the fights or anything that we've talked about this week. Give us a shout, 845-228-8710, 845-228-8710. And a special shout out to all the Fight Now viewers in the New York area. Are you going to be mad if you lose the Talking Boxing with Billy C Show? There's rumor that it's going to happen. Fight Now channel may be leaving the New York area. So give us a call. Let me know what you think about that. 845-228-8710. Iron Mike Promotions signed a Ukrainian Olympian from 2012. Evgen Kytrov. Yeah, whatever happened to Joe Smith and Bobby Jones and the easy names, you know? You know, Johnny Novak, the fighter. I used to know a Johnny Novak fighter, a lightweight out of Chicago. Kid was pretty good. He just never hooked up with the right people. But anyway, Iron Mike signed Evgen Kytrov to a promotional deal. Kytrov is a 4-0 fighter that's got four knockouts. So we'll see what happens with him. So congratulations. He is from the Ukraine, but he's living in Brooklyn, New York. Maybe he's watching right now. And he's being trained by Gary Stark. And as you hopefully recall, Gary Stark Jr. Used to be a pretty decent fighter out of New York. So anyway, congratulations to Mike Tyson. And speaking of Mike Tyson, Iron Mike Tyson and Larry Holmes are going to be going at it again. Except this time it's not going to be the way it was last time. It was announced today, and as a matter of fact, I want to thank my friends over at the Turning Stone. I was actually the first person to get this, and we immediately posted it up on the website, www.billycboxing.com. And this is why I tell you guys, you got to set your homepage to billycboxing.com, because we put boxing news, the only boxing news that's fit and worthwhile for your time, gets posted on the BillyCBoxing.com webpage. And in addition to our own staff of writers, we put other posts up there under the latest boxing news. So there's actually two sections where you can get the latest information in the sport of boxing right on the front page. And then if you go on the right side menu that says latest boxing news, you click that and you get it. And if you go there, you'll be able to see all about a special event that's taking place on Wednesday, June 4th, up at the Turning Stone Resort and Casino. Mike Tyson and Larry Holmes are going to be doing an interactive event. Basically, to be honest with you, they should have had this happened so quick. If I would have known a little sooner, I would have tried to be the moderator. They're having some local Yahoo radio guy, sports guy, doing the moderation between these two guys. It's an open forum. You've seen this style done before. Basically, they'll be sitting up on a stage or a podium, And people are going to be able to ask questions. And the moderator will ask some questions as well. But who would have been perfect for that? A boxing person asking these two Hall of Fame heavyweights boxing-related stuff. Come on. Yours truly, right? I mean, it would have been great. Would have been fun. Unfortunately, I'm not going to be there, and I'm not going to be there on Wednesday either, but you should be there too. You can check out our website, www.billycboxing.com, for all the information about this special event that's taking place at the Turning Stone with Larry Holmes and Iron Mike Tyson on Wednesday, June 4th. I believe it starts at 6 p.m. Eastern. We've been talking a lot about the big fight this weekend, Carl Froch against George Groves. It's the rematch. Now, I'm going to be breaking down this fight tomorrow and give you my official prediction along with all the other fights. We actually have 12 fights on this week's Billy C Challenge. I will give you the lowdown on the 12 fights here in a few minutes, and I will break them down and give you my predictions tomorrow. Now, if you're not part of the challenge and you want to be, just drop me an email, billy@talkingboxing.com. That's talkinboxing.com. We give away prizes every month, and this month, and we give a fantastic year-end prize as well for the person that wins the year-end average. But I tell you, we got a really close race going into this week. We have 12 fights on our schedule, and it's still up for grabs, man. It's still up for grabs. And one of the newer members is really in the driver's seat because he did so well last week. He was 10 out of 10. Even if he does the same, he's going to win for the month. So it's a very competitive challenge, and you can check out the standings if you visit billycboxing.com. You'll see the Billy C Challenge. Just click that, and that'll give you all the standings. But Carl Froch and Georgie Groves had their final press conference yesterday, and a couple of quotes. Georgie Groves says, there's about 56 hours, and remember, this took place yesterday. He said, there's 56 hours until I become a world champion. I can't wait, and it's a perfect place for it to happen. Anyone who has watched the buildup knows we're working on the left hook, and that's the punch that will win the fight for me. It's going to be a one-sided fight. Pretty confident, George Groves. Carl Froch says, I'm supremely confident for Saturday. He says, as a team, Rob and I have done what we needed to do, and now we're just going to enjoy it because of the titles, the stage of my career, the venue, and George. This is the biggest fight of my incredible career. George Groves will not hear the final bell. You know, interesting. And like I was saying yesterday, you know, all these press conferences are the same. You know, you got the same, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, I got you in that ring and I'm going to do this, you know. And a lot of times it's anticlimactic. These fighters don't do none of that. And they fight a totally different fight. Like George Groves saying, we've been working on left hook. Watch out for the left hook. The left hook is coming. The left hook is coming. And, you know, is that a ploy to get them looking for the left hook that never comes? Or is that, hey, you know, I got my, like in football, you know, we're going to run the ball. We're going to make no qualms about it. Here it is. You stop us, you know. So, interesting. My thoughts, and I'll break it down, like I said, fully tomorrow, but my thoughts on this fight is simply this. You know, the first fight got all of this, you know, press for being controversial and everything else. And, you know, when you watch the fight, it did start off in George Groves' favor. But Froch started coming back. And the stoppage, which was, you know, being ruled as premature, may not have been premature. You know, the referee's job is the safety of the fighter, and he was deemed, unable to defend himself and vulnerable against the ropes, and the fight was waved off. In this sport of boxing, you got to protect yourself at all times, and if you're in a situation like that, that's the risk you take. We saw that with the Curtis Stevens and Tiarino Johnson fight. I referenced that fight earlier in the week. To me, I'm still sick over that fight. But, the referee made a decision that, you know, he, that's his job. You know, Larry Hazard disagreed with my thoughts on that. And I got to respect Larry. Larry's been the third man in the ring more than I have. You know why? Because I've never been a referee. And he's a Hall of Famer. So, you know, we'll have to wait and see. All I know is 80,000 people are going to be live. And they sold the 60,000 seats in like an hour and a half. And then they put the other 20,000 on. I don't know how long it took them to sell it, but I know it sold out. Also this weekend, we have the Nonito Donaire challenging the WBA featherweight champion, Simpui Vitika. And they had their final press conference yesterday as well, as long along with the rest of the fighters on that card. I'm only going to quote these two guys, but Simpui Vitika says, "Thank you, Nonito, for accepting my challenge. I'm the champion, but I chose to fight Nonito, and he accepted. Fight night, I'll make sure I defend my title successfully. That's why I'm here." That statement amazed the crap out of me. You know, I wonder if it's true. You know, I wonder if Vitika really challenged Nonito Donaire. And if he did, that's pretty wild. And I think if he did do that, and it's true, I think that pretty much is proof enough for all you young whippersnappers out there. You know, I think that proves that a championship belt really means nothing. A champion, when was the last time you heard a champion say, "I challenge so-and-so to a fight"? The only time is if you're challenging a fellow world champion and you want a unification. But usually the champion is the guy. And then it's your job as a challenger to challenge the champion. I find this amazing. And the main reason why is because of money. They know that Nonito Donaire is a money fighter. He fights on HBO. He fights on pay-per-views. He has fought on a pay-per-view. I'm pretty sure he has. Maybe I'm mistaken, but nonetheless, you know you're going to make more money fighting him. So you know, Vitika challenges him, offers his belts. You know, it's pretty wild. Donaire says 2013 was a year I would say was covered in darkness, but that's how life is for me. This is a new beginning with Vitika. He's an amazing fighter, and we understand what he's capable of. For us, this is a statement, regardless of whether I have it or not. And that's something everyone will be excited to see, and we'll find out on Saturday. Interesting, too. You know, it's the first time I've ever heard Nonito Donaire actually make a statement that's realistic. To me, I've always looked at Nonito Donaire as a spoiled, rotten kid. I had the pleasure of meeting his father, Papa Donaire, in Canada at Casino Rama one time, and was a real smart guy and knew what he was doing, a fantastic trainer. And if you recall, Nonito fired his own father because of some conflicts with his wife. And Nonito Donaire had always kind of been a crybaby. You know, he complained, he bitched, he moaned, he signed with this promoter and then signed with another one when he still was signed with the first one, and then he had a lawsuit and all this stuff. You know, like I said, to me, he's like that spoiled, rotten kid that has everything and still wants more. You know, I do think this is an important fight for him, and we'll see. A good win over this guy, even though he's virtually unknown here in the States, is going to go a long way for Nonito Donaire, at least for his bank account, because it'll guarantee him another fight. In a couple of weeks, we're going to see Ruslan Pradognikov defend his WBO junior welterweight title against a kid that I really like, you know, and my man Big George Mitchell will be working in Chris Algieri's corner on June 14th on HBO in Brooklyn at the Barclays Center. You know, I really like Chris Algieri. I just honestly don't think he's ready for this fight, and I really think that they're rushing him a little bit. He does have the skill, but we're talking about Pradognikov, who's a badass MF'er, man. There's no question about that. Don't let those smiles and all of those, you know, every time you see him, he's smiling and looking like, you know, he's loving life. But I'll tell you, he's a bad dude. Anyway, Chris Algieri said, I haven't had those big name fights yet. I've only seen a couple on I've only been on TV a couple of times, but I've been working very hard throughout my career to get ready for an opportunity just like this one. And on June 14th, everyone's going to see who I am and what I bring to the table. And that's when everyone can see what Chris Algieri is all about. You know, the thing about that is, you know, you can't judge him by one fight. You know, if he doesn't come out on top in this fight, which I don't think he will, that doesn't mean he's done. You know, and like I was talking to a buddy of mine the other day, you know, sometimes you can't pass up opportunities. You can't pass up a world title shot, and you can't pass up a payday, specifically the biggest payday of your career. And I think that that's what Chris Algieri is doing right now. Ruslan Pradnikov, on the other hand, said this is a great opportunity. This is a great opponent and a great fight. All my career, I've had to fight guys taller than me with longer wingspans, and all I could do is try and get to them and pressure them. It's no secret what my game plan is. Of course, it's I'm going to pressure my opponent. They all try to outbox me, and they all try to outmove me and jab me, but I'm going to follow my plan and break the person down and win this fight come June 14th. Everyone will... see that I'm not trying to go the distance, and I'll break him down and win the fight. So that's what Pradnikov said. And we'll see. You know, I'm actually surprised that HBO bought this fight because I really don't see it being that competitive, to be honest with you. So finally got that damn gnat that was bothering the hell out of me. You know, he's flying in front of my face the whole time, and then, you know, I just squished his ass right on the mic. I don't know if you saw that, but anyway. So many things go on this boxing show. I mean, we kill gnats live, on the air, on TV, on the radio. Come on, man. Where else can you get entertainment like that? You know, you want me to start singing and dancing, too? No. Different show. Anyway. Freddie Roach was asked about the fight coming up next week between Miguel Cotto and Sergio Martinez, the guy that my man Alex Papali actually has under ruse of Sergio Martinez. And check this out. You know, Freddie Roach has been saying some pretty crazy stuff. I mean, listen, I give Freddie Roach credit for being a good trainer. He's able to make the proper adjustments during a fight. And I think that's what earns him his paycheck. But I tell you what doesn't earn him his paycheck is his ridiculous statements. And here's one. They were asking him about the fight coming up between Martinez and Cotto. And as you know, he trains Cotto now. He said, and I quote, they say the fight goes 9 rounds, meaning Team Martinez. He says, I think we'll win in 4 rounds. Miguel's ring generalship alone will win this fight. We have 2 more days of sparring, then 4 rounds of work, and that's it. We are ready to fight. It's pretty confident by Mr. Roach. You know, Miguel Cotto is going to be the smaller guy, and you know, Sergio Martinez has got punching power. He's got hand speed, but he is 40, and he is coming off not one but 2 surgeries. So maybe Freddie's right. But 4 rounds. Knockout Martinez in 4? I don't know. There's a new commissioner in town in New York State, and he is vying to change everything. His name is David Berlin, and it's a position that was actually newly created for him. His specific title is executive director. And he had an interview with the Daily News yesterday, and he said, it's a new beginning for me personally, and I also believe it's a new beginning for this commission. He said, that would be true of any agency with a new leadership. My first step is to listen and learn. I'm meeting with everyone involved with this commission to get their feedback in which ways we can improve. I will work to achieve the desired goals of this commission, which are to promote, maintain the health and safety integrity of regulated athletic activities. He's going to report to a board of commissioners consisting of a former commissioner, Melvina Lathan, Edward Torres, and John Signorelli. He also said one of the first goals was to restore the public's trust in the commission, which took the hit after the Mago Abdulzimov fight. He says, obviously, it's a desire of mine and that the public does have confidence in the way this commission is run. He says, I assure you that there's going to be some transparency in the way we're going to operate. And our job, again, is to have competent people in place, competent people on the staff, on this commission, and competent officials making decisions about the fights. He says that they said that Berlin's going to work with a full-time staff of four commission people in Manhattan. He said the commission's administrative and medical staffs are virtually unchanged since November when the Mago Abdulzimov fight happened. That's wrong. And I'm going to be bringing some of that to you directly in the near future. They actually fired the guy who was pretty much running boxing in New York State. They got rid of him. He was the scapegoat. You know, and the thing is that whole Mago Abdulzimov situation, to blame the commission is hard. It was an unfortunate situation, and one that I wish never happened, and I'm sure everybody else wishes it never happened. But to finger point the blame to the commission is kind of crazy. I don't know. Anyway, only time will tell. Here's the 12 fights that are part of this week's Billy C Challenge. We got Dmitry Chudinov against Patrick Nilsson, Tony Harrison against Bronco McCart, Envy Gradovich against Alexander Mashurkan, Luis Davalli against Luis Rosa, Manuel Char against Alexander Povetkin, Sam Solomon against Felix Sturm, Jishalan Maduma against Kevin Mitchell, James DeGalli against Brandon Gonzalez, Nicholas Walters against Vic Darchinian, Javier Fortuna against Juan Antonio Rodriguez, Simpawai Vatika against Nonito Donaire, and Carl Froch against George Groves. It's a tough, tough, tough week of fights. I would say at least four of these fights are 100% fitty-fitty fights. And speaking of fitty, did any of you guys catch 50 Cent's first pitch at the Mets game yesterday? Oh, my God. Oh, my God. I'm glad he doesn't try to do that for a living. I've seen girls do first pitches that were better. As a matter of fact, I saw a girl do a first pitch that she actually did like this acrobatic flip and then threw the ball as she was flipping, and it was right down the middle for almost a perfect strike. Well, let's just say that one of the fans in the 19th row almost got hit in the head with the baseball that Fitty threw out in yesterday's Met game. It is on the internet if you want to get a good chuckle.
Wake up. It's time for the...
It's too early
for a trivia question.
Question.
Alrighty then. Today's It's Too Early for a Trivia Question. Question is being brought to us by The Gentleman Boxer. Get yourself this fantastic read. The Gentleman Boxer is available where all good books are sold, including Barnes & Noble and Amazon.com. Today's It's Too Early for a Trivia Question is also being brought to us in part by the Titty Grab Game. If you're looking for a fun game to play with couples that are adults, of course, and maybe have some alcohol involved, then check out the Titty Grab Game. All the information about the game can be found on the website, www.tittygrab.com. And today's It's Too Early for a Trivia Question is also being brought to us by the Turning Stone Resort and Casino and their next boxing event, which is Friday. No, not tomorrow. A week from tomorrow. It's a Mike Tyson production. Get yourself some tickets by visiting turningstone.com or click on the fight poster, which is up on billycboxing.com. Make sure you tell them Billy C sent you. Today's It's Too Early for a Trivia Question, which is supplied to us by our trivia question guru himself, Henry Haskup, is a tough one that I'm going to give you a hint for. Which fighter that challenged for a world title ended up having the worst career record. Which fighter that challenged for a world title ended up having the worst career ever? Now, here's the thing. I said yesterday that it required a minimum of 10 fights. There's been several fighters that were brought in to make a pro debut against a champion over the course of time, and they lost. So I'm not counting that. This guy had a minimum of 10 fights. Well, here's the hint. He had 10 fights, all right? The guy who we're looking for here had 10 fights. So what fighter that had 10 fights total that challenged for a world title ended up having the worst career record? If you know this answer and you're the first one to email me, Billy at Talkin' Boxing, that's TalkinBoxing.com, you'll win the prize. Let me give you one more hint, because about six people emailed me Reggie Strickland. It is not Reggie Strickland.
This day in boxing history.
And finally, this day in boxing history is being brought to us by LDL TV and Billy C's Hall of Fame Weekend Special, taking place next week. All the information can be found by visiting our website, www.billycboxing.com, and click on the banner that says Hall of Fame Weekend Special. Special thanks to Sal's Neighborhood Pizzeria, the Courtyard by Marriott in East Syracuse, and the Wax Museum with Ronnie Dark Rock and Roll Show. On this day, May 29th, in 1988, Fluenzio Oblmiaz wins a 12-round decision over Chong Pal Park to win the WBA World Super Middleweight title, and that took place in South Korea on this day in 1988. On this day in 1988, tell me where you're from and which TV provider you called and requested the channel. Believe me, it'll help, and I would really appreciate it. Maybe I'll even send you a prize. Hey man, don't forget, tune in to the show same time tomorrow, same channel tomorrow. You know, bad time, bad channel. Come on, you know the deal. There's only one channel. It's called Fight Now. Call your local television provider and tell them you want to Fight Now channel, add it to your sports channel lineup. That simple. Pick up the phone and call. Looking for info on the channel? Simple. Visit the website, www.fightnow.com. We'll see you tomorrow. Ciao, baby.